Okay, thank you to be here. We start now. It's later. I want to thank Philippe Lamberts, here the president of the Greens in this parliament, because it's your idea, this post-growth event, and I believe it's a success. And we have to have another event next year, maybe. We don't know. We try. Dear colleagues, dear participants, welcome and thank you for coming today. Automation is one of the two key challenges that will define our future. We know that. The first one is climate change and all the ecological issues. The second is robotization, in which I include artificial intelligence and platform. Today, robotization is an unavoidable theme in social and political debates. These fast-moving and quite invisible changing technologies are more and more intertwined with us in our private and professional life. It is more than time then to acknowledge the fact that it is a growing concern among citizens. Over the past few years, robotization and artificial intelligence have made such progresses that today robots can easily replace cooks, police officers, conductors and factory workers all over the world. Studies show that 60% of profession will be at least partly automated over the next decade, and average scenario foresee between 400 and 800 million of people jobless because of automation. This estimation paints a bleak future for our current social and educational system. Up to now, we thought that job requiring human skills would be spared by automation, but it may not be the case, as robots like Amelia are already designed to show empathy. Automation will not only bring employment, but also uncertainty about the skills that will be necessary for workers to be complementary with artificial intelligence and robots. The way we work will be fundamentally different. We can now affirm that robotization will deeply affect the ground of our social protection systems. Therefore, whether we decide that our tools are adequate and that we just need to upgrade them, or we decide that we completely need to rethink the system to be able to cope with the changes occurring. It means rethinking our relationship with work and rebuilding our social protection systems. Yesterday, we talked about basic income, for example. I regret in this regard that the European Parliament did not go further last year to create a tax on robots to be able to fund a proper transition for workers. The Conservative majority was against. But it shows that we need to intensify the debate over this growing challenge. So, today, please welcome our panel, Victoria Smatko-Abaza from European Commission, Principal Advisor in DG AMP, my DG. Yes. Monica Kiss, researcher from the European Parliament Research Service. Thank you to be here. Aida Pons from the European Trade Union Institute, senior researcher in the Foresight Unit. And Pascal Lukic, it's a good Lukic?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Professor of Law, Sorbonne University, Paris, and co-author of Une autre voie est possible. Before I leave the floor to Mrs. Smatko, I would like to remind that the event is web-streamed. on Slido. You can download the app and share your comments on the device through the app. The code of event is hashtag F402. You can also post on social media using the hashtag PostGrowth 2018. Please.
Good morning, everybody. Soon to be afternoon or noon. I want to warm up everybody, and I want to give you unusual presentation for the European Parliament. So, first of all, introducing myself and my relationship with technology. Back in the 80s, I was a student, and I was learning how to code using mainframe machines and perfocards. In the 90s, I was a chief finance officer, and I was coming back to the university to study IT, operational systems, Norton Commander, and I was the first chief finance officer in my country to have a computer in the office. Then I considered myself very tech-savvy, and I was always following the flow and learning new apps and tech and so on. I used all possible gadgets, phone, pod, pad, and so on and so forth. I even gave a present to my 75-year-old mom, and she knows how to use it too. So, but preparing to this conference and making a presentation that I will show you right now, I found out myself almost obsolete. So let's start. You see, the tech doesn't work. Let me.
No, it doesn't work. Do you have a picture? No.
I think instead of reading the page of information, it's much easier to comprehend from the visual tool. So for this, I also want to use the iconographics, and we talk about the workforce skills, how they will shift, and what will happen to the workforce. And since I don't have much time to discuss each my slide, I prefer you look at it and maybe afterwards study it carefully. But we see the current situation, and what happened in the future we surely don't know today. The workforce definitely will shift. We try to anticipate the shift, and we try to understand what would be happening with the workforce, what type of workforce we will see in the future. Can we, in general, call working person or working people as a workforce? So we have restructuring, we have firing, we have retrainings, we have allocation of or redeployment and allocation of different things. So, in fact, it's not the concern only of the employer, it's rather concern of every one of us. And since the audience is mostly young, like my kids, I mean, the big kid is working right now, he is secured. The little kid is going to the university next year. As he was impressed by this presentation, called his friends and telling, do you know that this year we will get a new Germany born? And started to scare everybody of his classmates, telling that we don't need to go to study right now to the university in tech. Let's just think about social skills and how we will survive in this artificial intelligence world. But the questions right now in front, if we talk seriously, the questions in front of the politicians, social partners, and citizens of Europe and the world are the following. What kind of job will be replaced? Which sectors, regions will be affected? What the effects of working conditions and social protection? And is there a risk of growing inequality? So we deal with these questions. We deal very seriously and very carefully, and we have certain measures already taken, and we are looking forward to take further measures and anticipate change. But if you check the predictions of the future by authors, by futurists, by Hollywood in the end,
insurance claim workers with an AI system that will handle customers more efficiently. See these articles? They're written by algorithms, and we can't tell the difference with human-written content. And thinking of converting yourself to being an online poker player? Too late. There's an AI that can already beat humans at it. Most journalists, tax consultants, marketeers, technicians, knowledge workers, lawyers, even the person editing this video right now will to some extent have been impacted or automated by technology in a couple of years. And what have you been doing? Probably watching Netflix. And the problem is, the machines don't wait. And the machines, they don't watch Netflix. So what are the forces at play here? Basically, there's 10 million developers out there using increasingly simple and cheap technology to build new products and services. Some as young as 12 are already coding the future. Even that safe company you work for is increasingly under outside threat. And it's not just the Google, Amazon, Facebooks, and Apples of the world that I'm talking about. There are now tens of thousands of startups out there eating away at all sorts of jobs. Now, are they creating many jobs in the process? Let's look at some stats. Travel a bunch of years back to when Kodak ruled the world of photography. They were worth 38, what I'm talking about. There are now tens of thousands of startups out there eating away at all sorts of jobs. Now, are they creating many jobs in the process? Let's look at some stats. Travel a bunch of years back to when Kodak ruled the world of photography. They were worth $38 billion and employed 140,000 people. That's approximately $270,000 per employee.
Our people work with pride to make Kodak a creative and innovative company.
Fast forward to recent times, YouTube sold for $1.65 billion with a mere 65 employees. That's $25 million per employee. Instagram, which had 13 employees and was sold for $1 billion. That's $77 million per employee. WhatsApp sold for $19 billion with 55 employees. That's a staggering $345 million per employee. So how is this all possible? Technology has allowed the emergence of what we call exponential organizations. These are exponentially fast-growing companies that leverage technology and require less employees but more tech-savvy ones. You will find... Let's look at some stats. Travel a bunch of years back to when Kodak ruled the world of photography. They were worth $38 billion and employed 140,000 people. That's approximately $270,000 per employee.
Our people work with pride to make Kodak a creative and innovative company.
Fast forward to recent times, YouTube sold for $1.65 billion with a mere 65 employees. That's $25 million per employee. Instagram, which had 13 employees and was sold for $1 billion. That's $77 million per employee. WhatsApp sold for $19 billion with 55 employees. That's a staggering $345 million per employee. So how is this all possible? Technology has allowed the emergence of what we call exponential organizations. These are exponentially fast-growing companies that leverage technology and require less employees but more tech-savvy ones.
You will find that we are technology optimists. We believe that technology is a major driver of change in the world.
And as software continues to eat up the world, more companies are trying to replicate these exponential companies, hire less people but grow exponentially through technology. As this happens, job roles are slowly disappearing and being replaced by skill sets. Employers require you to know an ever-growing number of new and ever-changing fundamental skills in order to use the technologies they've implemented. Master the fundamentals and you can master the rest. A digital skills gap is growing for both mid-skill and high-skill level jobs. Before you know it, you become irrelevant. But wait, what's this doomsday message? There's actually a way to leverage technology before it leverages you. And in fact, it's never been easier to do so. This might sound kind of corny, but it starts with the right state of mind. It starts with having a growth mindset, where you have the desire and the confidence that you can learn anything. Shift your thinking on how these technologies will rattle and mutate, but enrich your work life. Because yes, if you play your cards right, technology will make your work life and your life in general much, much better. The fact is that technology will actually remove boring, repetitive jobs from your way, but only if you understand the fundamentals. And you have no excuse not to do so. How can you stay relevant if you can't talk the lingo? How can you stay relevant if you can't execute? Can you talk tech? Can you talk APIs? Can you talk code? Can you talk data? While slow educational institutions are struggling to keep up, that's not an excuse. Train yourself. Take your education in your own hands. Learn to code. Learn about behavioral psychology, automation tools, playing with data, user experiences. Be curious. And if you're an employer, train your people. Online and offline courses have never been more readily available or rich in content. It's time to build something. Your greatest credential in this new era is your output of stuff. Proof of your awesomeness. A website, a blog, a prototype, a simple data model. It's time to build cool stuff and showcase it. It's time to start learning. It's time to get shit done. It's time for your growth.
That's it. It's my message. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are we in a Netflix movie? A technologic nightmare. It's now our future. Can we imagine how to manage this new technological translation? It's Mrs. Case. Ask from me.
Good morning. I would like to introduce myself shortly. My name is Monika Kish. I work for the DG EPRS. It's the members' research service, and my domains are employment. So I'm dealing with employment issues and social security issues. And we've heard a very impressive general introduction how artificial intelligence, digitalization, robotization influences our everyday life. And in my intervention, I would like to zoom on some affected by these technological changes. On the other hand, jobs which involve non-routine tasks, so tasks which require, for example, social skills, dealing with people, improvisation are less affected. These jobs are, for example, in healthcare. These jobs are in education. So this kind of jobs are less affected by these changes. We have also differences. We can observe differences in different sectors of the economy. So more in danger are traditional manufacturing jobs. for example, chains in the manufacturing industry. Less in danger are high-tech manufacturing jobs, and even less the services sector. So it's not really, or it's much less affected by this. And another important aspect is the relation to innovation. So more innovative jobs with creative skills are less affected than less innovative jobs. Also, jobs related to emerging technologies, for instance, green jobs, jobs related to environment, goods and services, are less affected because they require new skills, and these skills workers who possess these skills are in demand. How these jobs are affected by automation, by robotization, by digitalization? There is a decreasing number of available jobs in some domains. Jobs become obsolete, and this is one tendency. Their workers are replaced by artificial intelligence, by robots. Then another tendency is the displacement of jobs. So jobs remain, but they are geographically displaced. So, for example, offshore production, outsourcing in other countries. Then another tendency is the new organization of tasks. So tasks persist. They are still on demand, but they are organized and dispersed in a different manner. So, for example, the internet-based distribution of work, platform work, instead of typical work contracts. Then there are new forms of employment. A typical work contract appear. There are more and more self-employed, bogus self-employed workers. Workers work on project-by-project basis more and more. Platform economy. There is a Eurofund study which identifies a lot of typical forms of employment. For example, employee sharing, when an individual worker is jointly hired by a group of employers. There is also job sharing. An employer hires two or more workers for the same job. Interim management, casual work, ICT-based mobile work, portfolio work, when a self-employed works for more employers. Crowd employment, collaborative employment. So there is a wide range of new types of work contracts which appears, and it has consequences on social security. It has consequences on other aspects of the economy. There are also positive impacts of automatization and digitalization. For example, in some cases, this flexibility, this atypical work contracts, can lead to a better work-life balance. For some workers, it is a positive development because they can realize a better work-life balance than before. It could be also, it could give also more self-determination, more freedom in executing work for some workers. Reduction of working time can also be a positive impact through automation because machines are executing a part of our work, so workers have to work less. And of course, there are the negative impacts already mentioned, so the insecurity of employment, involuntary unemployment, social security issues. So social security has to be adapted to this new atypical forms of work. Our social security systems in the European Union are adapted to stable long-term contracts with one employer. It's not feasible anymore. We have to change these social security systems in order to be able to deal with workers working in this atypical with this atypical work contracts and in this atypical situations. Pension schemes were financed by contributions deducted from salaries. They have to be revised as well, because workers in the platform economy will maybe not be able to pay regularly contributions for pensions. So all these are consequences on social security and pension issues. So, and I would like to finish my intervention with this. So, social security systems, the European Union has to stick to flexicurity. So, flexicurity involves flexibility. So,
eating away at all sorts of jobs. Now, are they creating many jobs in the process? Let's look at some stats. Travel a bunch of years back to when Kodak ruled the world of photography. They were worth $38 billion and employed 140,000 people. That's approximately $270,000 per employee.
Our people work with pride to make Kodak a creative and innovative company.
Fast forward to recent times, YouTube sold for $1.65 billion with a mere 65 employees. That's $25 million per employee. Instagram, which had 13 employees and was sold for $1 billion. That's $77 million per employee. WhatsApp sold for $19 billion with 55 employees. That's a staggering $345 million per employee. So how is this all possible? Technology has allowed the emergence of what we call exponential organizations. These are exponentially fast-growing companies that leverage technology and require less employees but more tech-savvy ones.
You will find that we are technology optimists. We believe that technology is a major driver of change in the world.
And as software continues to eat up the world, more companies are trying to replicate these exponential companies. Hire less people but grow exponentially through technology. As this happens, job roles are slowly disappearing and being replaced by skill sets. Employers require you to know an ever-growing number of new and ever-changing fundamental skills in order to use the technologies they've implemented. Master the fundamentals and you can master the rest. A digital skills gap is growing for both mid-skill and high-skill level jobs. Before you know it, you become irrelevant. But wait, what's this doomsday message? There's actually a way to leverage technology before it leverages you. And in fact, it's never been easier to do so. This might sound kind of corny, but it starts with the right state of mind. It starts with having a growth mindset, where you have the desire and the confidence that you can learn anything. Shift your thinking on how these technologies will rattle and mutate, but enrich your work life. Because yes, if you play your cards right, technology will make your work life and your life in general much, much better. The fact is that technology will actually remove boring, repetitive jobs from your way, but only if you understand the fundamentals. And you have no excuse not to do so. How can you stay relevant if you can't talk the lingo? How can you stay relevant if you can't execute? Can you talk tech? Can you talk APIs? Can you talk code? Can you talk data? While slow educational institutions are struggling to keep up, that's not an excuse. Train yourself. Take your education in your own hands. Learn to code. Learn about behavioral psychology, automation tools, playing with data, user experiences. Be curious. And if you're an employer, train your people. Online and offline courses have never been more readily available or rich in content. It's time to build something. Your greatest credential in this new era is your output of stuff. Proof of your awesomeness. A website, a blog, a prototype, a simple data model. It's time to build cool stuff and showcase it. It's time to start learning. It's time to get shit done. It's time for your growth.
That's it. It's my message. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are we in a Netflix movie? A technologic nightmare. It's now our future. Can we imagine how to manage this new technological translation? It's Mrs. Case ask from me.
Good morning. I would like to introduce myself shortly. My name is Monika Kish. I work for the DG EPRS. It's the Members Research Service, and my domains are employment. So I'm dealing with employment issues and social security issues. And we've heard a very impressive general introduction how artificial intelligence, digitalization, robotization influences our everyday life. And in my intervention, I would like to zoom on some affected by these technological changes. On the other hand, jobs which involve non-routine tasks, so tasks which require, for example, social skills, dealing with people, improvisation, are less affected. These jobs are, for example, in healthcare. These jobs are in education. So this kind of jobs are less affected by these changes. We have also differences, we can observe differences in different sectors of the economy. So more in danger are differences, we can observe differences in different sectors of the economy. So more in danger are traditional manufacturing jobs. For example, chains in the manufacturing industry. Less in danger are high-tech manufacturing jobs, and even less the services sector. So it's not really, or it's much less affected by this. And another important aspect is the relation to innovation. So more innovative jobs with creative skills are less affected than less innovative jobs. Also, jobs related to emerging technologies for different sectors of the economy. So more in danger are traditional manufacturing jobs. For example, chains in the manufacturing industry. Less in danger are high-tech manufacturing jobs, and even less the services sector. So it's not really, or it's much less affected by this. And another important aspect is the relation to innovation. So more innovative jobs with creative skills are less affected than less innovative jobs. Also, jobs related to emerging technologies. For instance, green jobs, jobs related to environment, goods and services, are less affected because they require new skills, and these skills and workers who possess these skills are in demand. How these jobs are affected by automation, by robotization, by digitalization? There is a decreasing number of available jobs in some domains. Jobs become obsolete, and this is one tendency. Their workers are replaced by artificial intelligence, by robots. Then another tendency is the displacement of jobs. So jobs remain, but they are geographically displaced. So, for example, offshore production, outsourcing in other countries. Then another tendency is the new organization of tasks. So tasks persist. They are still on demand, but they are organized and dispersed in a different manner. So, for example, the internet-based distribution of work, platform work, instead of typical work contracts. Then there are new forms of employment. A typical work contract appear. There are more and more self-employed, bogus self-employed workers. Workers work on project-by-project basis more and more. Platform economy. There is a Eurofund study which identifies a lot of typical forms of employment. For example, employee sharing. When an individual worker is jointly hired by a group of employers. There is also job sharing. An employer hires two or more workers for the same job. Interim management, casual work, ICT-based mobile work, portfolio work, when a self-employed works for more employers, crowd employment, collaborative employment. So there is a wide range of new types of work contracts which appears. And it has consequences on social security. It has consequences on other aspects of the economy. There are also positive impacts of automatization and digitization. For example, in some cases, this flexibility, this atypical work contracts, can lead to a better work-life balance. For some workers, it is a positive development because they can realize a better work-life balance than before. It could be also, it could give also more self-determination, more freedom in executing work for some workers. Reduction of working time can also be a positive impact through automation because machines are executing a part of our work, so workers have to work less. And of course, there are the negative impacts already mentioned, so the insecurity of employment, involuntary unemployment, social security issues. So social security has to be adapted to this new atypical forms of work. Our social security systems in the European Union are adapted to stable long-term contracts with one employer. It's not feasible anymore. We have to change these social security systems in order to be able to deal with workers working in this atypical with this atypical work contracts and in this atypical situations. Pension schemes were financed by contributions deducted from salaries. They have to be revised as well because workers in the platform economy will maybe not be able to pay regularly contributions for pensions. So all these are consequences on social security and pension issues. So and I would like to finish my intervention with this. So social security systems the European Union has to stick to flexicurity. So flexicurity involves flexibility. So it has to adapt to self-employed and more flexible working arrangements, but it involves also the security aspect. So it should enable a secure transition it should also cope with a typical work contract and structural changes. So we have to enlarge social security regulations in order to deal with these new changes. And I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. So we are you. Aida Pons, last year I supported a candidate for the presidential election in France. And he said, we are in a technological transition and it's impossible just to imagine more growth, more jobs as a solution. We need to imagine new social protections, etc., etc. But a lot of trade unioners were very against this view and saying how we could have a pressure under the employers if there is this scenario. So I believe it's a cruel question today for the trade unions. If there is this technological transition with its effects about jobs, how trade unions today could imagine a new social contract?
Well, good morning, everyone, and thank you very much for this invitation. I would like to pass a message to you and show you how artificial intelligence is impacting the world of work. And for doing so, I would like perhaps to draw the concepts that I have researched and put them together into one specific sector so you could see actually how it's really impacting. And it's a sector that touches ourselves at the core, which is the healthcare sector. Everybody has been a patient or has gone to a hospital or has been in touch with a doctor or a nurse or some other specialist. So we're going to see how this is impacted by AI, very specifically. So I will give a very broad picture of the workplace implications of AI. And from that, I will just select five game-changing dimensions on work. And just final remarks. So we see that, of course, we have already seen that the world is changing very fast thanks to big companies and smaller companies, and everybody's doing AI and talking the AI language. And we are not alone. China and other regions of the world are perhaps a little bit above ourselves here in Europe. But this is the world today. And what we see at the workplace are different aspects in professions, in the infrastructure, and I have just selected five, for example. We live in an interconnected environment, which means that we are not just connected via our clouds or mobiles, but the infrastructure is more and more interconnected. We have more virtual companies. And, of course, we don't see really the distinction between our online life and our offline life. There is no more frontier. Then personal qualifications are becoming more hybrid. Nurses have to be, of course, more socially oriented with their skills, coming with the patient, with the doctor, but they also have to deal with robots and AI systems at any hospital. Professions become more data loggers. The doctors need to pay attention to a patient between 9-30 seconds, depending on the country. It varies from the US to Europe, and they need just to input your data into the system. So they just become really data loggers, and data, data, data is now the way they work. Data protection. Who hasn't really been touched by data privacy, the new rights of all citizens and all people in Europe, and who is responsible of what? Doctors and nurses are becoming more cautious in doing their work because patients are more aware of their data rights, and they need to become also more cautious about that. And they need to be aware of information security. Remember, some months ago, there was a big hack, and healthcare system was completely shut down, and the patients couldn't receive their treatments. So what are these? I will draw now from the macro to the individual, the five game-changing dimensions in the work. So the first one being the work organization. And as I said before, we're working in an interconnected environment with the cloud, with virtual systems, and there is no really a sense of a workplace, going to the office, staying there for 8 hours, having a coffee break, and so on. Doctors now work with applications, and they can monitor patients remotely with an application. The same goes for nurses. They don't need to visit them anymore in their houses when it comes for home care work, because they can easily remote a patient with an application as well, or a medical device that stays safe and that they make sure to send a message so that the patient takes their medication on time and the right place. If the patient doesn't do so, then there is another signal that is sent to the doctor to advise that there's some interaction to be done there. So workplaces are being transformed. What happens here is that we have the rise of the platform workers or the gig workers, and this also applies to doctors and nurses. You don't longer need to go to the doctor to be treated of a disease or to ask for a question. There's another application where you can find your online digital doctor, already running out in Sweden. And also the fact that work, the doctors and nurses have more jobs, more work, and they need to work very fast. So that will cope without private companies just deciding which ethical guideline or which ethical principle to follow, and specifically for work to work very fast. So that will cope without private companies just deciding which ethical guideline or which ethical principle to follow. And specifically for workers, what is interesting here is that, we should bring workers right into the next level. Again, I would like to repeat, to bring them to become AI literate, to become critically engaged with the technological developments, and to avoid, of course, AI inequalities, because perhaps Europe is very lucky in having technological changes and advances, but let's look at other regions of the world. So thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Very interesting. Yes, because the robots today don't pay social taxes, but workers pay social taxes. And how we could have resources for our social system if the transition is real. It's today a real question for us, for the future, for the rights of the workers. Can we have a new way, an other way about this transition? The floor is for you.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. As you said, I'm going to speak about the proposals of a book that I have just written with Dominique Méda and Eric Ayer. It's an economist and a sociologue, and I'm a jurist, lawyer. And the idea is that the if we keep on the direction we have today, that is the priority is economic growth, we will be in great trouble. We have forgotten that the main purpose of regulation should not be the earnings of shareholders, should not be the well-being of legal entities like firms, but should be the well-being of people, the well-being of the nature, the protection of the nature. So our proposals are in favor of a new direction, with the main purpose being the well-being of people and the protection of the nature. So I'm going to give you a few points without developing the points. Points that we've developed in the book. The first point, which is directly linked to the subject of today, is that if we don't change our way, the status of employee is going to be replaced by the status of independent worker. So this is the first point. As a labor lawyer, I am very worried by the growth of new business models like Uber. These new business models function on the basis of independent workers. They have something like 90% of the people who work for Uber, it's nearly 95%, I think, are independent workers. And it is the same for all these platforms. It is very worrying because, as you know, the protection comes from labor law. If you are outside labor law, you have very limited protection. And it is a movement that we see in France, but in all European countries, and also in the US. I think that at the European level, we already have a directive on fixed-term contracts that provides that the normal contract is the indefinite contract. So we have already written in European labor law that the normal contract is the indefinite contract. Everybody knows that in practice it's not the case anymore. A great majority of contracts today are fixed-term contracts. But still the normality is in the law. It's important that regulation is made at EU level to state that the normality for work is the employee status. We had a very interesting case in California about Uber, again, saying that an organization, like a firm in principle, should function on the basis of employment contracts. You cannot build an organization with independent contractors. It doesn't make a collectivity. Okay, so this is the first point. Regulation could be made notably on the subject of economically dependent workers. All these workers that work for platforms, legally speaking, most of them are independent workers. It means that they don't have a contract of employment and the labor law doesn't apply to them. But even if they are legally independent workers, they are economically dependent. Some countries in Europe, like Spain, like Italy, have made regulation on this subject. It is a fundamental subject for the future of work. So it's probably very important to deal with this subject at EU level. Not only the protection of employees, but also the protection of dependent workers. So this is the first point. Second point that we develop in the book, we should not focus exclusively on employment, but also on work. What do I mean by that? In most countries, and the Commission is very much into this movement, the focus is on creating and protecting employment, creating new jobs, etc. Of course, it's fundamental. I'm not saying it's not fundamental. But by focusing on employment and not on work, we forget, we tend to forget, the quality of work. The quality of work. We put the focus on the quantity of work, and we tend to forget the quality of work. And if I say it more generally, it's a general tendency in capitalism today. It's we focus on a quantitative model, like with the economic growth, and we forget the issue of quality. And we are convinced that if we want to be able to compete with like people, countries like China, etc., we cannot compete on the basis of social costs. It's impossible. If we want to compete, we need to compete on the basis of quality. And quality of work, quality of goods, quality of services, etc. So focusing on work and not only on employment means that we should regulate again on working conditions. It's a good point that the EU is probably going to make a directive on the transparency and predictability of working conditions. That's a good thing. But if when you read the project, of course I don't have the time to develop, but when you read the project, it's mainly about information. So the main object of the project of directive on transparency, it's about information. The employer should inform the worker. I'm not saying that it's not important, but information is the weakest level of legal regulation. And you have different legal levels of regulation. The lowest level is
AI inequalities, because perhaps Europe is very lucky in having technological changes and advances, but let's look at other regions of the world. So thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Very interesting. Yes, because the robots today don't pay social taxes, but workers pay social taxes. And how we could have resources for our social system if the transition is real. It's today a real question. For us, for the future, for the rights of the workers. Can we have a new way, an other way about this transition? The floor is for you.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. As you said, I'm going to speak about the proposals of a book that I have just written with Dominique Méda and Eric Ayer. It's an economist and a sociologue, and I'm a lawyer. And the idea is that if we keep on the direction we have today, that is, the priority is economic growth, we will be in great trouble. We have forgotten that the main purpose of regulation should not be the earnings of shareholders, should not be the well-being of legal entities like firms, but should be the well-being of people, the well-being of the nature, the protection of the nature. So our proposals are in favor of a new direction, with the main purpose being the well-being of people and the protection of the nature. So I'm going to give you a few points without developing the points. Points that we've developed in the book. The first point, which is directly linked to the subject of today, is that if we don't change our way, the status of employee is going to be replaced by the status of independent worker. So this is the first point. As a labor lawyer, I am very worried by the growth of new business models like Uber. These new business models function on the basis of independent workers. They have something like 90% of the people who work for Uber, it's nearly 95%, I think, are independent workers. And it is the same for all these platforms. It is very worrying because, as you know, the protection comes from labor law. If you are outside labor law, you have very limited protection. And it is a movement that we see in France, but in all European countries, and also in the US. I think that at the European level, we already have a directive on fixed-term contracts that provides that the normal contract is the indefinite contract. So we have already written in European labor law that the normal contract is the indefinite contract. Everybody knows that in practice it's not the case anymore. A great majority of contracts today are fixed-term contracts, but still the normality is in the law. It's important that regulation is made at EU level to state that the normality for work is the employee status. We had a very interesting case in California about Uber again, saying that an organization, like a firm in principle, should function on the basis of employment contracts. You cannot build an organization with independent contractors. It doesn't make a collectivity. Okay, so this is the first point. Regulation could be made notably on the subject of economically dependent workers. All these workers that work for platforms, legally speaking, most of them are independent workers. It means that they don't have a contract of employment and the labor law doesn't apply to them. But even if they are legally independent workers, they are economically dependent. Some countries in Europe, like Spain, like Italy, have made regulation on this subject. It is a fundamental subject for the future of work. So it's probably very important to deal with this subject at EU level. Not only the protection of employees, but also the protection of dependent workers. So this is the first point. Second point that we develop in the book, we should not focus exclusively on employment, but also on work. What do I mean by that? In most countries, and the Commission is very much into this movement, the focus is on creating and protecting employment, creating new jobs, etc. Of course, it's fundamental. I'm not saying it's not fundamental. But by focusing on employment and not on work, we forget, and we tend to forget, the quality of work. The quality of work. We put the focus on the quantity of work, and we tend to forget the quality of work. And if I say it more generally, it's a general tendency in capitalism today. It's we focus on a quantitative model, like with the economic growth, and we forget the issue of quality. And we are convinced that if we want to be able to compete with countries like China, etc., we cannot compete on the basis of social costs. It's impossible. If we want to compete, we need to compete on the basis of quality. And quality of work, quality of goods, quality of services, etc. So focusing on work and not only on employment means that we should regulate again on working conditions. It's a good point that the EU is probably going to make a directive on the transparency and predictability of working conditions. That's a good thing. But if when you read the project, of course, I don't have the time to develop, but when you read the project, it's mainly about information. So the main object of the project of directive on transparency, it's about information. The employer should inform the worker. I'm not saying that it's not important, but information is the weakest level of legal regulation. And you have different levels of regulation. The lowest level is inform. Because what does it mean, inform? It means, okay, I can do whatever I want, but you are informed. So we need more than that. And when you read the project, you have minimum requirements, but it's very modest. Okay, but I think it's an important direction to take. So that was the second point. The third point is about the protection of human rights and, again, working conditions. France has, in 2017, passed a law on what we call le devoir de vigilance, the duty of care, the duty of diligence. Some other countries have done it, the UK, for example, but it's more modest, the Modern Slavery Act. I think the Netherlands have planned to do it, are going to do it. But it's not possible that only two or three countries do it in Europe. It has to be done at European level. It means that the duty of diligence means that a mother company is going to be liable for the acts of its subcontractors in foreign countries. It cannot be only France, Switzerland, the UK. It has to be the whole of Europe at European level. It's a responsibility of Europe to protect human rights. Further point, the fourth point, it comes back to the issue of the future of work. It's the issue of autonomy. You've dealt with this issue already. I told you that we can be worried that in the future the model becomes independent work and not employees. When you speak with young people, they are not attracted anymore by the status of employee, because the idea of being subordinated to an employer, the idea of having no autonomy is not attractive for the young people. They want autonomy, and they think that autonomy, you can find it as an independent contractor. So a very important stake for the modernization of labor law is to introduce more autonomy for employees within employment and not outside employment. It's a very, very complex issue, and we have to be careful when we deal with this issue, but it's important. It means autonomy at collective level, so this is the issue of co-determination. The employee should have more power of decision in the company, and it's also at individual level. For example, in the European pillar, you have a provision saying about the flexibility for employers. But there should also be flexibility for employees, what we can call reversed flexibility. The employee should also have the power to define his or her conditions of work. We have to be very careful. It's not to say that, like in the UK, the president Netflix, I think he said that some of his employees could go on holidays whenever they want. They can take, they can work on holidays the whole year if they want. The only requirement is that they do the work correctly and at the date that has been provided for. This is not what we should expect. But more autonomy for employees I think it's important to for that the status of employee remains attractive. I've nearly finished. The issue of wages is extremely important as well. We are convinced that, of course, it's not possible to have the French or the German minimum wage for the whole of Europe. It cannot be a project. But the issue of a European minimum wage is a very big issue, is an important issue. We need that. Speaking about the future of work is also speaking about the wages. What we propose is that the minimum wage would be at 60% of the median salary of each country. It's important as well to fight the social dumping. It's my nearly last point. Speaking about work is also speaking about the control of the respect of labor law. And we have a lot of difficulties, especially for EU regulation, with the respect of labor regulations. We don't have a body of labor inspectors at EU level. This is a very big issue as well. We cannot speak about protecting workers without speaking about the protection, the control, the mechanisms of control of the respect of the law. And we have to be very careful and to watch very closely the creation of the Labour Inspectors Authority. I don't remember how you call it.
European Labour Authority.
Yeah, the European Labour Authority. According to me, it's a very interesting project. But it mustn't be what we call in French, une coquille vide. I mean, there has to be content. It has to have power. And it is extremely important, notably for the fight against letterbox companies and abuses of social dumping. Maybe a very last point, because it's a very big issue in France at the moment, but not only in France, in most countries, the issue of dismissal. The argument according to which labor protection can be a handicap for the creation of jobs, the idea that if we have too much protection of employees, it's going to handicap towards the creation of jobs. It's an argument that plenty of economists have developed. And it's an argument that is heard at European level. This argument has made that in several countries in Europe, the law of dismissal has been attacked. In France, it's very much the case. And I remember have been in 2 or 3 years ago, I was invited by the European Commission in France, the Bureau of the European Commission in France, and they showed us the project of European Pillar for Social Rights. It was just a project. And the project spoke about, it's still the case, about the protection against dismissal. And there was a confusion in the first version of the European Pillar. The confusion was about the control of the fairness of dismissal. You have two types of possible requirements for the fairness of dismissal. You can require the employer to inform the employee about the grounds of dismissal. So you inform the employee that he has been, or he's going to be dismissed because he has drunk at work. Okay? This is a minimum requirement. And you have the normal requirement is a requirement of justification. So the employer must not only inform the employee of the ground, but the employer must have a fair ground of dismissal. And it's extremely important that we protect at EU level this requirement of a fair ground of dismissal. As you know, the model of employment at will, which is the US model, is exactly the opposite of this. And when I read the European Pillar, it's written, prior at Article 7 of the European Pillar, prior to any dismissal, workers have the right to be informed of the reasons and be granted a reasonable period of notice. So it's the basic requirement. It's not anymore a requirement of justification, but just a requirement of information. So I told you that 3 years ago there was hesitation by the... it was not clear. Right now it's clear. And they have, you have chosen the weak approach. Again, it's important. I know it's a bit better in the Charter of Fundamental Rights, Article 30, but requiring the fair ground of dismissal is probably one of the most important protection for employees. And with the development of precariousness, this is something we need very, very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Just about one thing. I wrote a report about social dumping, and Parliament voted it 2 years ago now. Inside, I read the idea of European inspection. The Commission is proposing, you know, one labor authority with this mission, I believe, about the coordination of inspection. But it's always the same. We have a real problem with member states because they don't want a real power about social issues at the European level. It's a real problem for us. If we want, and I agree, if we want to have a social regulation in Europe. Okay, thank you. Please. Your micro, please.
Good. Is it working? No, you have to switch it off.
Sorry.
Okay. Thank you very much for your presentations. My name is Alexandra Kövesh. I'm a researcher at the Corvinus University of Budapest. I do research on degrowth and the future of work. And please allow me to be a little bit longer than just posing two questions, because what we heard from Mr. Lambert yesterday was this is supposed to be a dialogue between degrowth and mainstream economic thinking. So... please allow me to bring in some degrowth perspectives on employment and the future of work. First of all, in the degrowth research area, we tend not to think about technology as a horse gone loose and wild. Technology is still something that humans create. And therefore, due to social dialogue, we could actually decide what we use technology for and how we use it. So when we talk about this and this happening, yes, this is happening, but we should see ourselves as kind of agents when this is happening and not just people going with the flow. So this is one premise. The other premise is that when we talk about technology, at the moment, we're not taking into account environmental and social costs that come with that technology. So when we look at the cow being milked by machines, if the environmental costs of making those machines were included in the whole process, maybe milking the cow by a machine would not be just as economically viable as we perceive now. Another thing is research clearly shows, and actually in the video we could see that the way technology is going now is creating inequality. And in the video, when we saw that how many employees made up how many millions or billions when the companies were sold, That's the whole point. But that money was not going to a lot of people. That money was going to a few people. So the way technology is working now, it's creating more and more inequality. So basically, the gains from efficiency or productivity that we have introducing technology is actually flowing to a few people, and society as a whole is currently not benefiting from it. We need to tackle that issue as well. And yesterday we were talking about the basic income, and I think that's one way of looking at it. Another thing is, when we're talking about skills and skills that we need to relearn and learn fast and whatever, I think those people who get to the European Parliament and sit here, they are capable of doing that. They are probably unable. But when that is the message, we're leaving billions of people behind who do not have the educational background, the social background, or the skills to actually do that, the basic skills. So we need to be a little more critical about that. What is our kind of suggestion to overcome that? When we're talking about security and job security, Mr. Lokiek mentioned that we need to stop focusing on employment and start focusing on work. And what I'm saying is that we need to stop focusing on work and somehow surpass this Protestant ethics of work and start looking at work from a completely different perspective, work being part of life, and start redefining work. And this redefinition of work would include work at home, work working for your community, doing your own gardening, doing your own laundry, doing work, paid work and unpaid work, work that you're doing for yourself, for your own education, for your own self-development. That's all work. Or participating in political decision-making, that's work as well. And I know I have to finish, but it would have been nice to have a degrowther in the panel so that these ideas can actually come up during the... Keynes, who wasn't a degrowther, he was a mainstream economist, and still in 1930 he actually said that the time would come when people can lay back and work less because what we need will be covered. And I think degrowthers say that we have reached this point. We can start reducing working time. We can start laying back, and we can start benefiting from the technological advances of the last centuries. So talking about time reduction, redefinition of work, and a lot of other things that I'm not going to go into. Thank you very much.
Personally, I agree all your points. Philippe?
I'd like to follow up exactly on that, because what struck me with a number of speakers, and especially the first two ones, is that the paradigm is, this is happening, humanity should adapt. But this is precisely what this conference is questioning. Don't we have an economy to serve humanity? Or do we have a humanity and nature to serve the economy? And no, sorry, but I do not share at all your sort of techno-enthusiasm or techno-naivety, I would say. We want this to serve us, not the other way around. And basically what you say is, well, adapt yourself to that system. No, we have to adapt the system to our needs. That system should serve us, human beings. And that was striking. And actually this system, well, this technological change is increasing the rent extraction power of the capitalists, or if you want, capital holders, if you want something less connotated. And that is abundantly obvious. And again, well, I liked what you said when saying, well, one employee, 25 million. Actually, it's not the employee. It's just a division of the turnover of the company or profit by the number of employees. In other terms, the work that is delivered by machines, well, that added value is captured by the owners of the machines, that is the capital owners. And this is where I find that the answers, and even I was disappointed, to be honest, by what the trade unions were saying, because it's a bit besides the point, saying, well, we should upskill people. Yeah, but you will not use billions of people programming. That won't happen. There's no use for that. So what I would have expected is first you to identify the contradictions, because I note that you say we are going to make more stuff more efficiently because machines will do it. And so we need less people. Tell me with what money the people will buy the stuff. It's all fine to have a McDonald's without any human being except the customers. But actually, if the customers do not have the money to get into the McDonald's, I'm not going there, but regardless, then what's the point? Henry Ford understood that his employees had to earn money to buy the stuff that Henry Ford was making. That at least he could connect the dots. But I do not see that connection in what you say. Another contradiction, more machines means more resources. Fact is, we have lithium, to take one example, to power 1 billion electric cars. We have 1 billion thermic cars in circulation, so we can replace them once. And so I don't know what your training is, but the economists believe that, well, technological progress will solve all this. I'm an engineer. I know the laws of thermodynamics, and I know that this is simply impossible. Even if you want to circularize the economy a bit more, you will not be able to have all the ingredients that you need to make all those robots. There's not enough on the planet. So actually, even if we would wish to, if the capitalists would wish to, they won't find the resources to find it, unless, of course, they destroy nature. And the last contradiction about, well, we have to reinforce collective bargaining. I mean, the Commission says that, and the Commission, in its annual recommendations to member states, increases pressure every year to reduce the bargaining power, to reduce collective bargaining. That's a contradiction. So what I would have expected, to be honest, from all the panelists to tell us, okay, if indeed we move to a world where more work is done by machines and less work done by human beings, what does that imply in terms of organization of the labor market? That is indeed, maybe we have to work 20 hours and not 38. By the way, the employment rate, look at those figures. I mean, in Europe, in Germany, the employment rate, not unemployment rate, the employment rate expressed in full-time equivalent is 68%. So 32% of the available working hours are not worked. And Germany does all it does without this, and with AI, maybe we'll get to 50% employment rate. So this is crazy. Second thing, what does that do to social protection systems? How do we need to adapt them? And that is, of course, linked to taxation, I'm sorry to say. I didn't see a lot of that. So that is where I'm frustrated a bit by what I hear, because to me, you are circling around the issues. You are, except maybe the last speaker, but you're not going to the heart of the issues. Basically, you take it for granted that, yes, capitalists will have a greater power to extract the rent from society and nature. And that is taken for granted. To me, I don't accept this. This is not the world I want to live in.
Okay, one speech again and after the response, yes. Please.
So I completely agree with the first lady and also with you as well in a lot of your points. So rather than just go back over what you said, I'll maybe just focus on something that I'm particularly interested in, which is in when you talk about employment and work, there's a lot of work that is done that is not remunerated, that is not paid for, and it's still essential work. So that's a lot of the stuff that's done in the household and in the community. And it's essential work, but just because it's not paid for by the market doesn't mean that it shouldn't be considered in a lot of what you're talking about for the future. And that goes on to care that cannot be replaced by technology, and it should not be replaced by technology. And in the videos, like for your talk at the start, I think you did a disservice by putting the videos in, because I think when you spoke, there was a lot more nuance to your words. But those videos were almost a dystopian future. Like, I thought it was a horror film that you were showing us. Like, the people in the last film were shouting at us, you've become irrelevant, and this is not the future that I want to live in. If that is what China or India or the United States is doing, then the European Union should be saying, okay, that's not for us. Here, I think people are the most relevant part of what we're talking about, and they have to be the most relevant part. So that, it was really scary. And as a citizen of Europe, I think if the European Union wants to still be essential in people's lives, you have to, as these speakers were saying, it's not about the people at the top that can reskill and that can be involved in this new revolution. You have to talk about social community cohesion, which is not, it wasn't mentioned at all in this. And I think if we're talking about the future of work and the future of the European Union, if you really want to not have bad things happen and people turning off from politics, the politicians and the European Commission needs to understand that people in the real world do not think in the same way as this. People in the real world want to have conversations with real people, and they don't want robots to replace everything. And robots can replace some of the bullshit jobs that happen, but at least for social care and community, this needs to be done by humans, and it can be done by humans, and it needs the institutions to protect them. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Maybe we start with you.
Sure. I appreciate your conversation very much and comments. And in fact, these movies were put to provoke the conversation, to provoke it, not to say that we are facing this future, to provoke the discussion. Because normally, during these conferences, there are not very much issues and statements from the audience. So I'm so glad that you heard. It's not to scare you. Mm-mm. Not knowing the risks doesn't mean they do not exist. It's just to be aware about what's happening and what are the opinions around us. What I put, and you didn't mention, I put two small slides about the risks which we are facing and we are recognizing in Europe and the measures we are taking. To talk about these measures will take not one day, not 3 minutes, not probably. I can bring you the volumes of what we are doing right now. But not to recognize what's happening around and what that we are called irrelevant. The capitalists are coming and taking the shares, that the startups are blooming, growing, and just grabbing and running. The Bitcoin is going to 20,000 per coin and going down to 4 and so on and so forth. And most of the many people, in fact, the energy of the world is used by digging the Bitcoins instead of thinking about what's happening and how to socialize and so on. So we have to know about this. I don't think that everybody knows about it. And to tell, okay, don't show, don't scare, don't do, maybe not. But it's a good provocation of the conversation. It's a good provocation of what the lady told. I just appreciate your statement. Because this is, I'm thinking of myself. But this is my personal opinion, which I'm not necessarily able to explain every time I see, you know, sit in a panel of such level. But when I talk to my friends, when I talk to you, for example, during the network lunch, I may tell you much more. But these movies are very good movies to start thinking.
You?
I would like to react because
yes, there was please,
very specific to the trade unions. And I'm very disappointed to hear Mr. Lambert said you were disappointed by the message provided by myself working at the European Trade Union Institute. And I'm disappointed that my message was not passed as I wished. I didn't say that reskilling is the solution. And I turned out to the Commission and I said, yeah, reskilling, it's obviously a good thing. I don't oppose, but... I said, but I advocate to instead of reskilling, going for AI literacy, what I call AI literacy, because reskilling serves one person for doing a specific task for a specific job for one employment. Once that specific person is gone, the skill perhaps is not longer usable as well. Instead, in swimming in this complexity of the world, dealing with new technology, what I think is more fair
for workers and non-workers is to level their level of AI literacy, you call it something else, something that can make them critically engage with what we swallow as technologies or we don't want to swallow. So that was my final message. Make the people critically engage with technology. This is the only way that we can decide whether the technologies that are developed on behalf of us are usable and are the technologies that we want to use. Because so far, we just buy the telephone or we work with a specific system designing or identifying a cancer for a radiologist, for a dermatologist, and what is the intervention from that professional into the design of the machine. So that's the message that I wanted to pass. And I also repeated two times in a kind of informal way, I really wouldn't like the society or the workers slash citizens to become the ball in the pinball machine. They have to be aware of all the risks that I provided. They have to be aware that they have rights and they can act upon different sets of technological change. The presentation that I was required to present to you was what's going on with AI and work, and this is what I come and say to you. And it presented a very specific case to make it more palpable for the audience. Thank you.
Let me just react on this remark on taxes. You are absolutely right. It's an important aspect when we talk about platform economy, because taxes and the platform economy is tricky issue because taxes paid on labor are not necessarily possible in this case, so maybe a tax paid on added value would be a better solution in this case.
Okay. No, just to say that I totally agree with what you're saying. It's probably one of the most fundamental points. There is in one of the directives of the EU, which is the directive of 1989 on health and safety. It's written that there should be, we should adapt the work to the individual. We should adapt the work to the individual. Actually, in our book, we have a chapter on this. It's the idea that it is not to the individual to adapt to work. It's to work to adapt to the individual. So what you say is fundamental. I take an example. We spoke about algorithm. With algorithm, we can say algorithm is the future. We can't do anything. So how do we regulate algorithm? With soft law. So we require information on algorithm. That's why I spoke about information a lot. No, it's not. We need hard law. We need to prohibit algorithm when algorithm is not appropriate. So it's very important, and it's a problem with the evolution of EU law. EU law now, it's mostly soft law. If we remain with a soft law approach, we will not be able to deal with the new the future of work. So for algorithm, for example, we should have prohibition of algorithm in the sphere of health, for example. If we don't do it, tomorrow, when you go to a doctor, it's an algorithm that is going to say what type of medicine you have. So it's extremely important what you say. We have a principle in EU law, but it's just in the directive. It should be in the treaty. The adaptation of work to the individual and not the opposites. It's fundamental. And concerning your point, actually, I completely agree with you. I didn't say that we shouldn't care about employment, but on work, we should care about both of them. And what you're thinking about work, I completely agree. Work is not only a job in the company. Work should be dealt with very, very broadly. So this is very, I completely agree as well.
Thank you. For me, there is a real problem because we always thinking about all the juridical, technological consequences of numerization, digitalization, robotization, but the true problem is the power. And the question of the redistribution of wealth, I don't know if in English it's a good word, but it's very important because there is a link between digitalization and inequalities. It's sure. And there is a link between inequalities and the doubt about democracy. That's sure. And that's why it's a political question today. For me, it's very important because if we don't have this perspective, we're just talking about a technical problem, how we could find job with more skills, etc., etc. And I don't believe that the real problem. The problem is the problem of power. How we could protect the power of citizens with this new period. It's a big challenge. Please.
Thank you. I would like to stick to a more narrow topic, which I would like to ask to Professor Pascal Lokiac. I'm sorry if I pronounce it wrong. And also to Aida Ponsen. So we have been witnessing lately the development and deployment of employee surveillance technologies and control. And I think it not only to, usually we think about Amazon employees in the warehouses, but it goes way beyond that to very high skill employees as well, sitting on computers, softwares that log into their webcams and take a picture to see if they are sitting on their place and what they're doing. So my specific question is this legal and should it be? And to Ms. Ponce, is this something that worries the European Trade Union Institute? And could the avoidance of this sort of surveillance be pushed through collective bargaining in the future? Thank you.
More questions, please?
Hello. I'm a human ecology student at Lund University. It's already building on what has already been said here, but maybe if we take a step back. My question is, the past 2 days we've been talking about the need to reduce resources throughput in the economy, and to me, all these technological innovations, they require a lot of resources. So I'm wondering if these scenarios are actually realistic. Is this really going to happen? Are we going to have the resources? I think it's what Mr. Lamberts was already asking. But also beyond the ecological limits, I'm wondering about the ethical and moral limits to all these scenarios. The correlation between ethics and law has already been brought up, but yes, I'm wondering where all those moral and ethical limits to having technology to that extent into our lives. Yes, I'm wondering if it's actually on the agenda as well. Thank you.
My name is Arnold Bomans from the Dutch Footprint Network. And my question is, wouldn't this be also a chance for introducing the basic income, because all the dirty or monotonous jobs could be done by robots, etc.?
Hello, my name is Ernesto. I'm a member of the Spanish Green Party, and I would like to ask, because I feel really scared about one sentence that I saw in one of the videos, that the aim of the companies nowadays is to grow exponentially, applying the technology but using less workforce. It's like, okay, what's the point on this, trying to be growth, and what's the point of this in the rural areas? I live in a rural area in the north of Spain, and for example, Netflix doesn't make my life better. my life better is the environment, social capabilities. I need the stability in my jobs, and we have no employment. So my question is, which is the solution for the rural areas more far beyond than quantitative easing? I mean, we need stability. I think that the solution could be move backwards and use the traditional jobs, applying the technology to that job, and not the other way around. Thank you very much.
I am Sachin Baba from Cambridge Econometrics. I totally agree with the point about feeding the AI that you mentioned. I think it's totally within our control. I think the technology that beat the chess master was fed millions of pieces of data of old chess games. But if we can't control this growth in technology, then I think the policy needs to get wiser. On the employment side, can we introduce something like a quota where per sector there is a ratio of robots employed to humans, and maybe this can be done in companies as well. And particularly, like you said about the healthcare sector, maybe it should be zero. Thank you.
Our last question, please.
Hello, my name is Lieven Hofmann. I'm currently studying philosophy and economics in Germany. And I have just a short question about, I don't know if you mentioned the schedule of today, Mr. Chair, because I feel like there's a lot of agreement on the panel about things which were said in the discussion, and I would really appreciate to hear more of this. And my question is if this is still possible. And yeah, there were a lot of things already said, so I don't really want to say anything more about it. Thank you.
Just two points. First, your question about the control of the employee. You're right. It's the big issue is that of power. As you say, Guillaume Ballas, it is a big issue. The main issue is that of power. Power has changed in the company. In the traditional work, the employer has a knowledge and directs the employee. But with new technologies, with the future of work, the employer is not able to direct the work anymore. So direction of work is replaced by control. So the only thing that the employer can do on its employees is control. And this is why we have a huge development of techniques of control. So if, as you rightly say, a big issue is the control of the worker and how can we limit and regulate the control of the worker. Legally speaking, it's not very easy. The main tool at the moment is human rights, fundamental rights, notably the right to privacy. Because this, like, when you work at home and when the employer is able to see through his through your computer what you are doing, or if you are on your computer, it's a problem of right of privacy. But again, it's a big issue, and we will have to make more precise regulation than just big declaration of fundamental rights. So this is the issue. And concerning your question from Spain, it is a problematic of what is a firm. It's not labor law anymore. It's company law. We also need to change company law. A company, in most countries, the goal of a company, legally speaking, is to make profits. Legally speaking, a company is composed of shareholders, the company, the contract. Legally speaking, in most countries, the company is, legally speaking, it's a contract. It's a contract between shareholders. And as a consequence, employees, furnishers, clients, customers, and the state and the environment, all these are third parties, and they are not part of the company. And a very important point, again, is to reconceptualize the firm. And for you who think about new forms of growth, you have to think about what is a firm. What is the firm? We have this is a debate we have in France. We need to reconceptualize the firm so that the firm incorporates the interest of the employees, the interest of the state, etc. So this is the two points I wanted to make with regard to your questions.
Thank you very much for all the questions which were asked and all the opinions which were discussed and expressed here. From the side of the Commission, there is a request to all of you to be active and participate in social dialogue with the Commission and to be active in discussing of any proposal, regulation, communication that we put online, and it's open for public consultations. We don't get much reply. We put a document online, which then criticized by the lawyers, by the trade unions, by social partners, but not by the citizens, not most of the time. Citizens do not know about us or ignore about us, and then they face what they have at the end. And we work. And if I listen, for example, all these issues and all these suggestions while I'm working on the European Labour Agency, I would appreciate getting these fresh ideas immediately when I work on a draft. Because you have to understand that I am sitting in the pot for 11 years and I already maybe not as much exposed to the realities of life like you are. Same for my colleagues. So we work in a legal framework. We deal with the Parliament, we deal with the Council, with the representatives of you, but we don't hear you. So thank you very much that I provoked you for this discussion with the slides or notes or movies which I do not agree with, but I wanted to hear the answer. Because it's the question for me, first of all. The question for me, the message from you that I delivered to my colleagues, and we will work on something which is better than now.
Okay, thank you very much for the reflections and the questions. And I will like to touch upon the issue of surveillance at work. In my view, it touches, obviously, as it has been said, a fundamental right, which is the right to privacy. I don't think it should be legal. Yes, workers are highly worried about that, and it doesn't mean that it touches high-skilled workers or low-skilled workers. It touches everywhere. We have surveillance with CCTV cameras, it's kind of usual in many workplaces, but we also have geo-tracking with truck drivers, or going back to the healthcare sector with the home care workers, and geo-tracking in the shape of a chip inserted in the uniform of nurses to see whether they have been washed or not. And this happens in Italy. And also we have tracking through the apps, again, with doctors who are doing the home visits with patients and with other mobile devices. So it's a huge worry for workers. And what they have been starting to do, specifically in the UK, is a new type of collective agreement, which is the use of technology of the workplace. And they're trying to insert a clause in which they limit the surveillance exclusively to very specific issues, perhaps time or it depends. The thing about workplace surveillance is that it can track time and other types of data, but it also tracks or indirectly behavior, and this is really, really very worrying as well. So with the hopefully these collective agreements could be replicated in many parts of Europe and sectors and so on. There's also another example in Norway with the municipal healthcare workers. They have created a collective agreement as well, and also a new role, which is very innovative, which is digital agents. So some workers are working as digital agents in order to see how other colleagues are using technology, what type of risk and problems they are facing in using the technology, and which are the worries. So the digital agents serve as a kind of a worker representative on digitalization and bring the feedback from workers back to employment and the municipality. On the quote of the robots, it's a very good, I wouldn't like to have a lot of robots at the workplace, but it could be an interesting solution. Zero robots in the healthcare sector. Yes, of course, but the reality is, and I was just last week in London at the AI Med conference, where all these devices and applications were presented to doctors, and they were fascinated by the fact that they could ease their work by having tools that could facilitate the prediction and prevention of diseases. So not all of them are quite keen on using these technologies, but it's difficult when you get into the profession to make them aware of the risks and worries that are around the use of AI. So that's why to touch upon the question of ethics and law. It's very nice to have ethical guidelines. As I said before, it's brilliant. Everybody has to say yes to ethics, great, but the ethical principles of Microsoft might not be the same as my ethical principles or might not be the same as yours. So everybody nowadays, including the Commission, is trying to do ethical guidelines in order, / soft law, in order to navigate around AI because they think that it's the best way to go through. And slowly and naively, they are trying to push away legal requirements or minimum requirements by doing let's do good AI. So I believe that there is a need to pull back the issues regarding liabilities, surveillance, privacy, data protection, worker protection, instead of having 50 types of AI guidelines or codes of ethics or whatever it's put out with a fancy name. So that's my contribution for this.
I just wanted to react to the question about the apparent contradiction between reducing resources, which is an important issue nowadays, and technological innovation. So it should not be contradictory. In some cases it might be, but some technological innovations are intended to use less resources and to save resources and to protect environment, and it should be enhanced. And environment protection and technological innovation should be in line, linking the use of renewable energies and technological innovation should be encouraged and ensured. And it, in my opinion, it should be a part of regulations on technological innovations to take care of the environmental dimension, because indeed it's really important.
About a point about basic income. Because yesterday when we were working about basic income, one idea increased why companies today can have our data, personal data, but they don't pay anything about that. Why we can't imagine a link between this personal data and a contribution by the company for basic income? That could be a view about a fundamental right for the citizen to protect our data, and if this data are using by companies, we have a contribution by this company. That's just one idea, but I never I never heard this idea before yesterday, just for a contribution about that. One more question, or please.
I want to say that the first intervener and Mr. Lamberts, I think, said some very crucial issues about putting the context of work in the context of the larger question of degrowth and economic development. I see two different futures. One future is where basically artificial intelligence and technology will continue to take the attention of people who influence the stock market. And so a small number of highly trained workers and small number of concentrated industries will continue to contribute to the economic advance of nations, and the rest of the labor force will be left in the dust. The other possibility is that people will realize that the issue facing both sides of the Atlantic is basically a diminution of purchasing power and the ability to buy the products of the industrial state. We will go one way or the other. We will have a fractionated economy, which is doing very well in the statistics. And as Brynjolfsson and McAfee in their American book called The Second Machine Age, we will hollow out the middle class, or people will wake up and understand that this model of economic development, and I'm not talking against capitalism, I'm talking against capitalism which has been captured and regulated to basically only benefit one side of the polity. We are at a crucial time in both Europe and the United States. Years ago, I wrote a law review article on technology bargaining, arguing that labor ought to have a bigger role in the American context in bargaining about technological change. Now, we have no labor movement in the United States. There's a residual labor movement in Europe. And it is very crucial that we go beyond, even though I endorse labor protection, that we go into the fundamental issue, which is, what is the industrial state about? The fact that there's so few of us in this session, and are a large number, among, I'll presume, in the session on the second floor, tells you that the attention is not being focused where it needs to be.
Hello. Drawing on what's been said before, considering the macroeconomic picture, can you hear me? Hello? Okay. Drawing on what's been said before just now. Okay. Hi. So the macroeconomic policies is what is of crucial issue, I believe. If we look at the inflation targets that's been that are being set by the central banks, and we consider the huge amount of capital and money that is circulating, I do not believe that any of the issues or the solutions that we heard before can be of big enough scope to deal with the disruption ahead or heading our way with artificial intelligence and the massive increase in productivity that I would assume that comes with it. So I would love to hear what you have to say about that. Thank you.
Macroeconomic issues? Helicopter money? No. we were talking about that yesterday, also about basic income, how we could have public resources for minimum for basic income, and there is this idea of helicopter money. Why not? We know persons like Yanis Varoufakis, the previous Minister of Economy in Greece as a project with helicopter money. For a contribution for basic income, a citizen basic income in Europe. Okay, maybe we could now stop our meeting. Thank again to the panelists. It's not a very easy exercise because we have a real discussion with the room. That's the idea of this post-growth event. To have a real exchange with the citizens, and it's a possibility to progress in the discussion. Thank you for all this work. I would like to underline a point that I made in the introduction. Really, today our society is facing two main challenges: climate and robotization. I believe that we can say with enough certainty that these two trends will represent a break with the past. And it's very important because I'm a historian, it's my formation, and I had always hearing it's the same thing, there is no problem, crisis in capitalism, technological progress, and I don't believe that. I believe there is today a really a break with the past, because of there is no the same creation of job today with the progress of technology in the world. And I believe the link is breaking. The link is breaking, and if we don't think about that, if we don't prepare a new society with this new fact, so we could see how the citizen power decrease and how the democracy could be in danger, because a lot of citizens today are saying democracy can't protect us in this new world. And I believe it's the roots of populism and this new extreme right in Europe, in United States, etc., etc. I don't believe people are really nationalists, but they have no idea by the progressive. Movements today about the regulation of this new world. And when nationalists are coming and saying we have a traditional framework to protect your interest, if the nation, your ethnic roots, etc., etc., your identity, so because of progressist and democrat parties are in the impossibility to say anything, they chose a clear, simple way. So that's why it's very important to have, I believe, a new political contract about how we could find a way with this new robotization and all these technological changes. About taxation, very important. Who pay for our social protection? Companies? Workers? Robots? Who? First question. Second question, how we can find democracy when we want to take decision, if there is only the shareholders today who can decide for us in companies. And the third is all the problem of the social protection, maybe it's a moment to think about a new pillar. I don't believe in the way to change all social protection by one basic income. I believe it's catastrophic if we think like that. But I believe maybe at the moment to imagine a new income, a basic income, one more social pillar in this future world.